How are you, Professor? So nice to see you after such a while.
Oh, well, I feel happy that I get to see you.
One of the reasons I wanted to speak to you is because you understand finances of poor people and the impact of poverty on women. So I wanted to get a sense from you on how is this COVID crisis and the ensuing economic crisis going to affect the poor, their availability of credit, and women among the poor. What are your thoughts and how should we think about this going forward?
Yeah, it's the same old story. It's not new that I've been raising this issue. The financial system is designed in a very wrong way. So coronavirus, what it has done is reveal the weaknesses of the society in a very ugly way that you can see it now. These are hidden away into the society. We got used to it. It's there. The poor people are there. Migrant workers are in the city. They are hiding in the city. We have our people working for us, cooking food for us. They're a security person for us, darwan for us. They're taking care of our children. We knew them. But suddenly we see millions of them on the highway trying to go home. It's revealed that suddenly all the city migrant workers are coming out of the city in a big crowd and going out. For a simple reason, they have nothing here. They have no life here because no money here to survive. So the ultimate place they can go back to is their home. So they desperately they are going home. And then on foot, 1,000-mile journey. That's the saddest part of the whole thing. That's what the coronavirus has revealed us. So we have to recognize these people. The economics doesn't recognize these people. They call it informal sector. Yeah. Informal sector means we have nothing to do with them. They are not part of the economy. Economy begins with the formal sector. We are busy with the formal sector. If we can only finance them, we can take care of them, pay attention to them, they will be moving up the ladder because they have the basic ingredients of them. And they know how to fight for their life and they know how to make it happen. But we ignore them. And comes the women. Women is the remotest of all. This, if you're looking at the structure, this is the lowest structure. They have no voice, nothing in the society and our traditions make them completely separate from them. They are the basic strength of the society. All the entrepreneurial ability, when microcredit came, when it went to the women, they showed how much entrepreneurial capacity they had. And that's why the microcredit known for the whole world, not just Bangladesh, India. It's the whole world, because they have shown their work. They can fight, they know, they have the skill, they have the artisanal skills of all kinds, beautiful skills. And they are all forgotten because they belong to the what we call informal sector.
The tragedy, of course, is that countries like Bangladesh, countries like India, these are the biggest assets. These micro entrepreneurs, they are the future. They're where the money is going to be. There's where the growth is going to be. But for some reason, the system is not interested in looking at them at all. Because they don't exist.
Absolutely. We followed the Western way of doing things in the financial system and the economic system. So we didn't think about the vibrant capacity of the people, countries like India, Bangladesh, and Indonesia. They have the tremendous tenacity to do things and make things happen, very creative way. That creativity has to be admired and supported. But government has stayed away. It's an informal sector. You have nothing to do. Rural economy has become an appendix to the urban economy. Again, a traditional Western way of looking at the economy. It's the hub of activities. And the rural economy is the supplier of the labor. It's the labor-producing factory. Hmm. And they will be sending to their people to the cities to find a job. If you don't find a job, you'll have a bad luck. And you rot there inside the city. Why can't we have the economy of the rural area built as a separate parallel economy, autonomous economy, rather than have an appendix like that? Today, the situation has changed than 100 years back. Technology has given us the facility which never existed before. Cities were important because it has the infrastructure. Rural areas didn't have the infrastructure. Today, infrastructure is not limited to urban areas. You have the telecommunication, you have the road, you have the transportations, you have the communications, everything is there. So what is it that you have to go to the city to? Why can't we create an economy? People can live where they are born and have a livelihood, basic livelihood right there.
If you look at the way technology is going, decentralization, the mobile phone, the computer basically getting spread all over the world, entering different niches, probably you're looking at a future that looks very much like you're saying. Because 20 years ago, you couldn't possibly utilize the rural economy to do some of the type of jobs that it is, that is required today. Whereas with technology, there's no reason why disaggregated, decentralized manufacturing can't take place in a rural environment. However, you would need to restructure the education system completely. You would need to restructure the healthcare system completely. You will have to basically restructure the whole thing if you want to move in that direction. I don't think you can think in the same way and achieve what you're saying. I don't think it's possible. So
yeah.
I think it's a completely new page that you're talking about. I don't think it's a incremental thing.
Yeah. That's again another point I wanted to underline because of the corona pandemic. I said corona pandemic suddenly stopped the whole machine, the economic machine globally, and stopped everything. Now the whole trust is coming, whole push is coming, that how quickly we can go back to where we're coming from. I said, what is the hurry to go back? Should we at all go back? Because that world was a very horrible world. It was creating a world with global warming and giving us a kind of countdown when the world will be finished in a few years, in a couple of decades, 3 decades maybe. World would be at a stage where nobody can survive anymore. Why do we have to go back to that world? And why do we have to go to the world with global warming, with wealth concentration? All the wealth in that world is moving to few hands. And most of the people have nothing to do with the wealth anymore. So why do we have to go back to that system to create wealth concentration? Why do we have to go back to that world where artificial intelligence is taking away jobs for everybody? All the massive unemployment that will be created in the next few decades. Do we have to go back to it? I said, going back will be suicidal. So this coronavirus has given us a chance to think new, opportunity to make a break. That's what the point you raised. We are not thinking about it. We got so used to it. Now suddenly we said, we got an opportunity now. Let's go a different way. And these are the different ways. Unless we take those bold decisions, this is the time to take extremely bold decisions, outrageously bold decisions right now. It's not just about quietly go back to where we are and kind of celebrate that we are back again. Our doors, our shops are open.
Model is not an Indian model or a Bangladeshi model. This is a completely Western model that we have adopted lock, stock and barrel. We have, we have aped this model, and then we have realized that this model is not all it seems. This model has serious problems. This model has serious contradictions. It destroys the environment. It destroys societies. And I mean, if I think about Mahatma Gandhi, he 78 years ago was saying that we need to think about the rural economy. We need to think about our traditional structures. Now, of course, we've had a journey and that's an important journey. But I think the idea of rethinking some of these designs based on, you know, an Indian structure, a Bangladeshi structure, an Asian structure would be quite a powerful, powerful thing. So I think I agree with you that the game needs to be equalized for rural people and a imagination. And Corona gives us an opportunity to have a brand new imagination, which comes from within us as opposed to from outside us. I think one little
amendment to that. Absolutely agree with the basic thrust of it. This is not an Asian phenomenon. This is not an Indian phenomenon. This is not a Bangladeshi phenomenon. This is a global phenomenon.
Absolutely.
The proof is when we started Grameen Bank in Bangladesh lending money, they thought it's a Bangladeshi phenomenon. This is a crazy country. They do crazy things. And suddenly they became an Asian phenomenon. Oh, they do crazy things. Now it's a global because it's not the problem of Bangladesh alone.
But Yunusji, there are flavors that are local. So for example, I visited you in Bangladesh and the Bangladesh flavor, I agree that the central problem is the same, but the flavor and the solution is slightly different based on the culture of the place. For example, we have a caste-based society. We have a completely different type of structure than, say, the United States, which has which doesn't have a caste-based society. So our structures that emerge are slightly different, even though the problem is the same.
The basic thing is same. You have the caste system. USA has a race system,
right?
Worse than the caste system. You cannot compete with each other. So it comes in a different shapes and size and colors. That's all. The human culture is the basic culture. We have to go back to that human culture. We all belong. And that's what happened. When the poor women start joining them in bank groups, they're not thinking that she belongs to this religion, I belong to that. They didn't care which religion they are. They're in the same group. Five women from different religion getting together, working together, become very close friends. So the fault is in the design of the environment, what we have created around him, around her. So this is the time that coronavirus has put them all into sleep. So don't wake them up. Create new system. Bring up new system. Make the beginning of the new system. 1,000-mile journey starts with the first step. Let's make that first step during the coronavirus. A very determined first step.
So the heart of what you're saying is you have to trust and believe in people. That's the foundation. You start by trusting, believing in them, having faith in them, and then build institutions that empower that trust.
Yeah, exactly.
Versus, we don't trust you. You're poor, so you don't understand anything. Instead, you're poor. We understand that you understand everything that needs to be understood. We just are going to give you the supporting mechanism that is going to allow you to thrive and grow.
Absolutely. And again, my experience in Grameen Bank, you visited us in 2008, if you remember. And you visited for 5 days, not just one day, visiting women. How did we do that? What was the basis of that? People were shocked that we are giving so much money in their hand. 1,000 rupees for them is a big money. 2,000, 10,000 is a big money for them, who handled only 20 rupee kind of money. Now you're giving 1,000. And I said, well, we believe in them. We believe in their capacity, and they believe in us. It's a mutual trust. We don't need any papers. In the entire banking, in the Grameen system, there is no paper. There is no collateral. And I say, make fun of it. I said, Grameen Bank is the only bank in the world which is lawyer-free. We have no legal papers or anything. So if a bank can function on trust, it showed the basic strength of the people. An institution built where billions of dollars are given away every year as a loan and comes back with interest, and you become a strong organization. Flood comes, cyclone comes, everything washed away, but the Grameen Bank becomes stronger.
But look, I have a personal experience of this, and I think your experience sort of, you will understand what I'm saying. I came to see you, and you know that we built what we built in Uttar Pradesh, the huge institution that we built, millions of women. And then I found a extremely powerful organization, millions of women empowered, millions of women pulled out of poverty. Then I found myself with a government that decided to attack it. So I agree with you, but there is a piece missing in what you're saying, which is the political reality, which is that these systems that you built in a very small way, I built in Uttar Pradesh, it disturbs people. And then they come to destroy it. You'll understand where I'm coming from. So I'll challenge you, and I'm sure you'll give me an answer. In this environment where other institutions, other political instruments are attacking the type of institution that you're talking about building, how do you defend it and how do you build it? What are the type of elements that you need to have embedded in it that can either work with or co-opt these other institutions that are in a sense competitors?
Yeah, some institutions like government has a tremendous power to destroy things and push things away from the action and so on. But my position is, if we are doing something for people and people liked it and people enjoy it, no matter how powerful you are, it's a temporary dislocation.
Right.
This will come back. You cannot stop it because it worked for people. And if it spreads, if you stop it in Uttar Pradesh, in other states and other places, it will spring up with more strength than you have tried, because it will come back with a big force to revive again, because it works for people. is indestructible. Ideas, good ideas are indestructible.
But how do you feel about going back? Are you trying to bring out bailout packages and make sure that all the big industries go back again to their actions? Or this is a time to think a little bit? How do you...
I think the immediate issue in India, massive issue, was the migrants issue.
Yeah.
And what you call the micro entrepreneurs who were suddenly found themselves stranded. And I spoke to quite a few of them, and I saw firsthand what they were going through. Literally, their world had just fallen apart and they were forced to go back to their village. So the first aspect of it was trying to look after those people immediately. And there, our perspective was give them food, give them cash injection directly to keep them afloat. The government had a different view. They didn't really do that. They sort of didn't feel that was necessary. Then we had this big crisis of millions of people going home, walking thousands of miles. I suspect you had it in Bangladesh as well. But I completely agree with you. I think that if you don't come out of Corona with a new imagination, you've missed a huge opportunity, both as an individual and as a nation. I think what Corona is telling you is that what you have been doing so far is problematic. And as you're saying, reset. Start with a blank page and start with a new imagination. Of course, you can't make a jump like that in governance, but at least the mind should go there. And then the rest of the institutions and other things will follow. So I completely agree with you that if there's ever been a time for a change in imagination, I think the world changed its imagination after the World War II, the last time, the real big imagination and change. And I think Corona is such an opportunity that we can just reimagine things and rebuild them. I also think that countries like ours have a bigger opportunity than other countries simply because we have so much more room to play with, so many more younger people, and we have a lot more to build than, say, the Western world, which has already built a lot of their infrastructure.
Oh, well, one more question I wanted to ask, because you are in the context of huge big country and huge big nation. What would you see the next generation, second generation in India will see the world like? Are we in that path, that the dream of the world that you want to give to the second generation and third generation of India? Is this the path that you are pursuing? Like, the reason I'm asking this, all the teenagers marching on the street all over the world, Fridays for Future, accusing their parents that you destroyed our life. You are totally responsible, creating a world of global warming, and you're not paying any attention whatsoever whether we will survive at all in that world. It's our life at risk. Do you feel the same way that the young people are feeling? Or?
In India, there is a clear feeling that something has gone very wrong. Mm-hmm. That feeling is there in the people, and particularly in the young people, that something has gone wrong. Something is not working. And they can also see the thing that pinches in India the most is the difference between the rich and the poor. It's just astronomical. And it is so in your face that it is there in poor people's face every day, every day, every day. So that disturbs people. And so there is a sense that there is something new is required, a new imagination is required. And I think that's what we are working on, that as an opposition, working on helping sort of flesh out what that new imagination would look like.
Well, same problem. It's billionaires are growing here.
Yeah.
Out of nowhere, number of billionaires are growing. It's very strange in a country like Bangladesh or India. You have a high growth rate of billionaires in numbers, wealth, but in numbers, they keep on growing it. In a very fast rate, faster and faster rate. So that means that the wealth has only one direction. It goes in a very fast way. If it continues, then all the political understanding among the people that we can live together, it disappears because of the anger that it generates, that I work hard, I don't get anything, I have to go miles to find my livelihood somewhere else, and I can't feed my family, I can't feed my children, I have to stay away from my children, stay away from my family, to make a living for myself and my family. So that anger take over the whole society completely.
So it's at the heart of what you're saying, you're questioning the concept of greed.
Exactly, that's the whole thing. The whole problem.
You're saying the problem is greed.
Greed
and question greed.
It was always fueling the greed. Everything that we have done is to fuel the greed. And then we destroyed the whole world. So this is the chance. I said Corona has given us a chance to reflect, to see how bold decisions can be taken. These are bold decisions. In normal situation, we will not pay attention to all these ideas. We are so busy making money. So I said coronavirus gave us a respite, gave us a window of thinking, and we have a choice now, whether we go to that terrible world, which is going to destroy itself anyway, or we go someplace else, which can build a new world, where there'll be no global warming, no wealth concentration, no unemployment. It's possible.
Well, thank you very much for your time.
Thank
I'm not
you.
Going to take any more of it, but it's always a pleasure. And any chance of you coming here?
Well, let Corona go down.
When it goes down, we're looking forward to seeing you.
Yeah, and, it looks
and all my love to everybody in the family and everybody in the organization.